Our Bible word is Exodus 20, the verses 2 to 3. I am the Lord your God, who brought you out of the land of Egypt, out of the house of bondage. You shall have no other gods before me. So here we have a passage from the Ten Commandments, or it's also called the Decalogue, the Ten Words. But there are, of course, prescriptions, God's law. And if we understand it in the overall setting, if we look at the books of Moses, it's also referred to as the Pentateuch, or the five books. We have Genesis, which is about the creation of the world and its inhabitants, and also the stories of the ancestors, that's Abraham, Jacob, and Joseph, etc. Exodus, that's the book where the Israelites are in Egypt, also about the Passover and the Exodus from Egypt. That's from chapters 1 to 15. And after that, it's about Israel in the wilderness. And if you go to Exodus 20 to 40, that is where Israel is at Mount Sinai. And Israel at Mount Sinai, that's quite a big tradition in the books of Moses. So it spans Exodus and also Leviticus. It also goes into Numbers. And from Numbers, they go over to the desert wandering for 40 years. And of course, eventually where Moses leads them to the land of Moab, just east of the Jordan River. Of course, that then goes over into the book of Deuteronomy. So if we look at Mount Sinai, it's also called the Mountain of God or Mount Horeb. So the question is, where is this Mount Sinai? Is it there in the Sinai Peninsula? Or there's better evidence, actually, it's there more on the other side there. It's in the land of Midian, today Saudi Arabia, that this can be the location for Mount Sinai. But here, God's people just delivered from Egypt and after their exodus and their wanderings in the desert, etc., or in the wilderness, now they come to Mount Sinai. And Exodus 20 is mostly about, or the beginning part of it is about God giving the law or the Ten Commandments. There's also other commandments that come after this in other books of Moses. The rabbis say there are 613 commandments in these books that Jews or Israelites are expected to obey. But our focus is here on the Ten Commandments. And the Israelites are gathered there at the base of the mountain. And there's smoke and lightning and thunder. And because at this stage, God is like a warrior king. He's Yahweh, the God of Israel, and he reveals himself in the smoke and thunder as this also this warrior God. And the background also are treaties or covenants. At this time, many nations, peoples, kings and their vassals, or if two people make a covenant, an agreement or a treaty, it's an agreement, it's like a contract. You know, this party is expected to do stuff, that party is expected to do stuff, and if they don't, even in those treaties, there will be curses. So if you do not do your obligations, you will be cursed. Something bad will happen to you. And there's also something similar going on here. This is a treaty between God and his people. Now, this is expected of what these people are to do. And it also comes with curses for violations or blessings for obedience. For example, if you look at some of the curses, if you go to verses 5b, it says, "For I, the Lord your God, am a jealous God, visiting the iniquity of the fathers upon the children to the third and fourth generations of those who hate me." Another curse we find in verse 7b. That's about where they must not take the Lord's name in vain. "For the Lord will not hold him guiltless who takes his name in vain." So there is this curses that will happen, but also blessing for obedience. If we go to verse 6, if they remain true to serving and worshiping God alone, it says there, "But showing mercy to thousands, to those who love me and keep my commandments." A similar blessing also happens in verse, the second part of verse 12. That's about if you honor your father and your mother, it promises there that your days may be long upon the land which the Lord your God is giving you. So, curses for disobedience or for violating the treaty, but also blessings for obedience if you keep to this commandment. There's also discussion on how the commandments must be divided up. We follow a particular structure of it in terms of first commandment, second commandment. The thing is, in the Bible itself, they're not numbered. It doesn't say this is the first commandment, this is the second commandment, etc. For example, if we go to the first commandment, it's our Bible word. I am the Lord your God, who brought you out of the land of Egypt, out of the house of bondage. You shall have no other gods before me. Now, according to our tradition, if you read the catechism, part of the first commandment is also verse 4. Other church traditions say, no, this is the second commandment. We understand it in our church as part of the first commandment, which says, you shall not make for yourself a carved image, any likeness of anything that is in heaven above, or that is in the earth beneath, or that is in the water under the earth. You shall not bow down to them nor serve them, for I, the Lord your God, am a jealous God, etc. It also gives that curse if you do not worship God. For us, the next commandment starts in verse 7. You shall not take the name of the Lord your God in vain. That's according to our interpretive tradition, our church. It goes back to the 4th century. So down the ages, it's some Protestant churches who understand the numbering of the commandments differently. But our 10 commandments, we find it in Exodus 20. There's also a parallel version. If we go to Deuteronomy 5, verses 7 to 21, there the 10 commandments is also repeated. So the first three commandments focus on a relationship with God. The rest is about relationship with our neighbor. Because the third commandment is also observing the Sabbath. That's the day of rest and worship of God, etc. So the first three commandments focuses on God. Especially we worship God alone. What's also important to understand is that at the time when these commandments were given or written down, it would have been understood differently. Because the Israelites, they were not monotheists at this stage. Early on, they were polytheists. This is not a controversial thing. It's in even some other texts in the Bible suggested, also the archaeology, the many statues that were discovered. Because many believed God had a wife called Asherah and they had children. And that understanding of polytheism later evolved into what's called henotheism. Henotheism is like you devote yourself to one God, but you don't deny other gods exist. But the Israelites, especially at the reforms of Hezekiah and also Josiah, that's in the 7th, 6th centuries BC, just before the time of the exile, there were these reforms to say, no, we must worship Yahweh alone. We must banish Asherah. Any ideas, if you read of like sacred poles, say other sacred altars that were smashed, it refers to that kind of worship. It's also a time when worship was centralized in Jerusalem. From the time of the exile, that is when monotheism, the belief in one God, really took shape for the Israelites. So then this commandment will be read and understood differently. Before that time, where it speaks of you shall have no other gods before me, it was understood that, okay, we focus on Yahweh. We will not worship other gods. They exist, but we don't worship them. We worship Yahweh only. From the time of the exile, it was understood there's one God, no other gods. There was this thinking that developed. That's where the idea of idolatry really took shape. That the nations, the Gentiles, they worship nonsense, these false gods who don't exist. So there was development in thought and understanding of God. Now, of course, monotheism then became a very central thing for the Jewish people. That's what made them distinct in the ancient world. Because other people, 99.99%, they were polytheists or whatever believed in many gods or whatever. Now, for us Christians, the Ten Commandments is also important because Jesus also brought attention to it. If you go to that account of then Mark 10, verses 17 to 27, Jesus encounters that young man. And that young man asks him, you know, what must I do to be saved? And then Jesus lists him some commandments. And he says, well, I did that from all my youth, etc. So Jesus did teach about the commandments. More specifically also, and as it relates to our Bible passage, is Jesus also brought emphasis to monotheism, worship God alone. And we can also go there to Mark 12, where Jesus is asked, you know, what's the greatest commandment? Now, if we go read verse 29. Jesus answered him, the first of all the commandments is, hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. That brings attention to the monotheism, the first commandment of the Ten Commandments. So yeah, Jesus affirms it. Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. And you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, and with all your strength. This is the first commandment. So Jesus connects here with the Old Testament, especially if we go read the Old Testament reference to this. We find this in Deuteronomy 6, also in Deuteronomy 11. A related passage is also in Numbers 15, there, verses 37 to 41. Because the Jews at this time, they also performed that saying, hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. It's known as the Shema prayer. And Shema means hear or listen. And it says there, hear, Shema, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. And that prayer, devout Jews would recite every morning, every evening. Devout Jews, they would also put phylacteries on their heads, those little boxes where it's, and also around their arms that covers little pieces of scripture. They would recite this Shema, hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. So Jesus emphasizes this is the first commandment. Again, bring attention to the oneness of God that is unique, this monotheism. But interestingly, he also connects this focus on God, worship of God alone, and love for God with love for neighbor. Because in his response, Jesus also quoted Leviticus 19, verse 18. And the second, that's the second commandment, like it, is this. You shall love your neighbor as yourself. There is no other commandment greater than these. So for Jesus, he reaffirms this monotheism, he reaffirms that the idea of to love God entirely, worship him alone, but he connects that with love for neighbor. He says there's no other commandment greater than this. So the Ten Commandments, whether you read about it in Exodus 20 or Deuteronomy 5, front and center is monotheism. Like I mentioned, that worship of God alone would have been understood differently. At an earlier time, there would have been a movement from polytheism to henotheism to monotheism, like we understand God it today. There is one God. There's not many gods. And yeah, the Ten Commandments puts front and center, also affirmed by Jesus in the Gospels, that we are to worship God alone. He is one. And that we must also love him.